up, everybody, and welcome back to my channel. As always, I really hope you're enjoying Halloween so far. Today's video is definitely an interesting one. It is an unsolved murder, and it also kind of intertwines with a serial killer, and at that, a very terrifying one, slash also potentially involves a cult. It's definitely something interesting, and I honestly could have put every single one of these different topics within this video into its own video, but I didn't want to kind of extend this out over the entire course of Halloween, so I'm kind of cramming it in all together. I highly suggest, if you're interested in it, definitely go do some more research, because I probably spent more time looking into this than any other video that I've done this entire week. The serial killer in particular slash possible cult is terrifying, which is also why I didn't do its own separate video, because it could possibly still be a thing. So, that being said, we're going to go ahead and jump right into today's video, which is on a couple, Ronald Sisman and Elizabeth Platzman, and their murder, how horrific it was, who was possibly behind it, and it's still unsolved. So it's definitely a wild case. Sit down, buckle in, and prepare yourself. Now, Ronald Sisman was a 37-year-old man that was a photographer, and he ran both of his businesses out of his home in Chelsea, Manhattan, where he shared his home with his 20-year-old girlfriend, Elizabeth, who was currently a Smith College student. Now, during the early morning hours of October 31st, 1981, Ronald and Elizabeth were both brutally murdered. Their bodies were found at around 7:40 p.m. that night on their third floor duplex at 207 West 22nd Street in Chelsea. Now, police arrived at the crime scene and described it as something out of an absolute horror movie. They had both been severely beaten, they had both been put on their knees and shot execution style, and the entire apartment was ransacked. But it wasn't just slightly ransacked, their apartment furniture had been shredded to pieces, things were thrown everywhere, there wasn't a drawer or area that didn't seem to be searched. So this really led authorities to believe that they likely had someone kill them, and then this person was more than likely searching for something very specific within the apartment. But when they really started looking into things around the apartment and tried to see if there was something that was missing, they found out that the only things that were missing were the IDs or any form of identification for either Elizabeth or Ronald. All of that was totally gone from the apartment, as well as Ronald's pistol. And while the couple seemed to be a fairly average couple, Ronald had a spotty past. He had been accused of being involved in a few scandals. He was a photographer, but he also worked closely with Hollywood. He worked with different directors, he worked with different actresses, and he was also known for having potential involvement in drugs. And while authorities were searching Ronald and Elizabeth's apartment, they also discovered a large amount of drugs and side of the home. So this began to make authorities wonder if maybe this was all drug related and motivated. And on top of this, as I said, this wasn't Ronald's first run-in with drugs and potential scandal. An actress named Melanie Haller had accused Ronald of trying to force her to take drugs in May of 1980, so not too long before the murders of Ronald and Elizabeth occurred. Ms. Haller had originally charged Ronald for this incident, and they were wondering if maybe someone that knew her or knew at this point, because it was public knowledge that he had access to drugs and potentially tried to drug her. They wondered if maybe this triggered someone to finding him and trying to get these drugs, but it didn't make a lot of sense because the whole house was ransacked, but the drugs weren't ever taken out of the home. So authorities decided to go ahead and rule this out as a possibility. However, I personally think that was ruled out a little bit quickly. It was public knowledge that he was involved with drugs, which yes, could have been a motivation. However, wherever he got these drugs from, it's also likely he might have owed somebody money. Authorities then started to wonder if maybe this was just a robbery gone wrong. After all, Ronald ran two different photography businesses out of his apartment, which meant he had a lot of high-value items inside this home. But again, this didn't make sense because nothing of the sort was really taken out of the home when it came to any of his photography equipment. So they were wondering if maybe Ronald tried to stop them or Elizabeth tried to stop them and they ended up having to murder them and ran without anything. But again, this didn't really make a lot of sense, so they weren't getting much of anywhere with the case until they finally caught a break, but this took them in an entirely different direction. A prison snitch ended up leaking information to authorities that led them to believe that a fellow inmate potentially was involved in the murder. And it wasn't just any inmate, it was a man named David Berkowitz, and a man that was also known as the Son of Sam Killer. And this is the serial killer that I was talking about, and I don't think I've been more petrified of a serial killer. So to give a little bit of background on David Berkowitz. So he had a really, really rough upbringing in life. His mother ended up giving him away at a very young age. I'm pretty sure within days of giving birth to him. His mother that adopted him ended up passing away of cancer. He was struggling a lot from a very early age, likely from traumatic experiences. He was of above average intelligence, but he seemed to have no interest in school and instead started just setting things on fire. He wouldn't listen. He was almost impossible to discipline. He was sent to many different psychiatrists to try to maybe figure out what was wrong, what was happening, and he kind of knew how to manipulate them into thinking that he was absolutely fine, and the behavior would just in turn continue. He carried on with his life. He, I'm pretty sure, was in the army for a while. He ended up being dishonorably discharged, and after this is when he started his murder spree. So he is known as the Son of Sam Killer, but the Son of Sam could also potentially be a cult. And to this day, nobody has figured out if it's a real thing or not. He was also known as the 44 caliber killer because the 44 caliber was the weapon he chose to use on every single one of his victims. He had originally started off just using knives, but the first murder that he attempted was very, very unsuccessful, and that's when he kind of moved on to a 44 caliber gun. He started killing in 1976 and kind of branched out all over the different boroughs of New York City. He ended up killing a total of 6 people and injuring 7. So he wasn't necessarily successful on a lot of his different attempts, and he did get better with time, as terrifying as that really is. And he's also thought to have started over 1,000 separate fires across New York City, but I don't think he's been able to be linked to any of that. But he was a serial arson as well. Like, they know from things that he stated, they know from different circumstances, he more than likely did start majority of these fires. So David Berkowitz, because he grew up in such a rocky family, he seemed to have a very deep issue with women. Likely women that matched appearance to those that had kind of, in his eyes, screwed him over. He had in fact gone back after years and years and years and reunited with his mother, but his mother kind of sent him into a spiral because she admitted to all the things that happened in his childhood. She had been with multiple different men. There is a big question out there of who exactly his father was. I don't think if he ever figured it out or if this information really is anywhere. I personally couldn't find it. She kind of told him how many people threw him off and really pushed him away and wanted nothing to do with him. And then on top of that, when his adoptive mother died, his dad remarried to another woman that he didn't get along with. So despite the fact that a lot of these women were kind of forced into situations that were either beyond their control or, you know, they made the best decision they could, he really resented them for it. And he believed that these women are what caused all of this distress in his life. Women are the reason that nobody wanted him. They are the main ones that didn't want him. They made him feel like he had no place in the world. So that's why in the end he ended up specifically targeting women, mainly with long brown hair, and he usually never attacked one person at a time. He always attacked couples. Now, he did attack a lot of male and female couples. A lot of people believe he didn't know that these males were males because they did have long brown wavy hair. Again, this is the 70s. That was really common hairstyle for men. So they do believe that most of these killings were in fact thought to be directed at women only. So in 1978, David Berkowitz was finally captured and arrested. He had sent a string of letters to different government officials and reporters, basically saying he was part of the Son of Sam, that he was worshiping Satan. Now, this threw a lot of people for a loop and assumed there was something wrong with his mental health. So he was sent in for a psych evaluation and actually passed completely, which allowed him to stand trial as they saw he was competent enough. But basically the gist of it is that he said one of his neighbors had a dog and the dog was possessed by the devil, essentially, or at least a demon. And the lab would tell him that he needed to go out and kill young women because this dog needed their blood because he was getting old and needed younger blood to survive, basically. And this dog would tell him to do these things and wouldn't allow him to stop committing these murders. It just was a very interesting story. I highly suggest you go read up more on it if you can. During one of his trials, he actually came out and said that whole story was a lie, that he just wanted to kill these people, that it had everything to do with the woman in his life. But people wondered if his different sessions with mental health professionals maybe kind of nudged him to give this separate story that made more sense to people, maybe in hopes of getting sympathy, or, you know, to really get people off of the idea that he was, you know, a Son of Sam. Because after he was in prison for a few years, he actually came out and said, after denying this whole demon dog situation, that the Son of Sam was actually a cult, that there were many, many people within the Sons of Sam cult, that they were all the sons and that they all acted out together. And he even said that he wasn't the only one there for all of his separate murders within the Son of Sam killings. Now, no one really knew what to believe because he talked about this demon dog and then he, you know, denied it. And then he comes back and like lists all these names of people that were involved. And when people started digging in deeper, a lot of the people that he claimed were a part of the cult died in very bizarre circumstances right after David Berkowitz was put into prison. They had questionable backgrounds. They ended up being linked to him either by being neighbors or, you know, even the person who took the dispatch call when authorities were trying to get a warrant to search his home was, I think, the sister of one of the people that he claimed. And it's so odd how that intertwined in such a large place like New York City. So enough things started happening where people started digging deep into the different crime scenes, and people really believed it was very possible that there really is a Son of Sam cult and all these different people were working together to act out these murders. So for instance, at a lot of the different murders, there were very different descriptions that were given. And the descriptions that were given were mainly given by people who had been attacked and ended up making it. And all of the killings were done by the same bullet. They were able to prove these different things. So the fact that the same type of gun was used, yet all these descriptions were so vastly different, made authorities really think, yes, it's highly possible there's more than one person. And on top of that, when they started looking at the logistics of the different crimes, it was even proven in some of them that the way that these people were killed and like the different locations bullets were coming from and then things played out, there's no way it could have been acted out by a single person alone, simply based off the whole logistics of the crime. This was such a huge possibility, and enough people started bringing up questionable information that authorities actually reopened all of the cases. And to this day that I know of, they're all still open because it's such a huge possibility that the Son of Sam cult does exist and they have been out there killing these people. Also, because David Berkowitz was actually sending police departments and different members of law enforcement books and things with cryptic messages in them, and they all ended up linking back to a very questionable murder. And this whole time he had been in prison, and when these murders happened he was in prison, but somehow he knew all of this very interesting information about them that he shouldn't have actually known. And the case of Ronald and Elizabeth is one of those that falls into this category. And that's how this whole thing kind of ties in together. So Berkowitz told this informant that came forward saying that, you know, he had something to do with the murder of Ronald and Elizabeth, because apparently Berkowitz stated that he was part of a satanic cult, aka the Sons of Sam, and they planned to perform a ritual on Halloween night at a photographer's apartment in Greenwich Village. Now, authorities kind of brush this off at first because Greenwich Village and Chelsea are not the same place, and they believed, you know, he maybe was just making things up. But people really started looking into more of what he said, and it was very possible he just kind of slipped up on the location. According to Berkowitz, the cult planned to break into the couple's home, beat them, shoot them in the head execution style, and then ransack the apartment, all in the name of Satan. So it sounded very similar to his story about the demon dog telling them what to do and they just acted out these murders. And how he said they all played out matched exactly with how Elizabeth and Ronald were murdered. But then, just like the other time, Berkowitz ended up kind of leaking out possibly a different motive. And this is what really got people believing something happened here and Berkowitz was definitely involved, or at least the Sons of Sam cult was involved. So Berkowitz ended up telling this informant that the male photographer that they were planning on killing actually had photographic evidence of one of the Son of Sam murders that he had committed along with his cult members. And a lot of the people in the cult were afraid that he would turn it over to police to get out of this drug charge that he had. So basically, they hadn't been too concerned about this photographic evidence, but once Ronald was kind of charged with forcing Melanie Haller to take drugs, they were worried he now had a reason to use this picture as leverage and it would take the Son of Sam cult down. Authorities at this point really believed there was a possible strong connection here, so they decided to go and talk to Berkowitz themselves, and they were shocked when he was able to accurately describe the entire apartment. Like, every single thing he was able to talk about in specific detail. And even though this makes it seem obvious that he was speaking to someone involved with this crime, it wasn't enough to prove that he had anything to do with the murders. And because they had no evidence that there was actually a Son of Sam cult, they just kind of had to leave it because they couldn't corroborate any of these claims. When it comes to Berkowitz, there's really no telling if what he said about the murders of Elizabeth and Ronald were true, and to this day, again, they have no way of proving anything. So their case is actually still open, all the different Son of Sam cases. No one really knows for sure what happened at this point. So when it comes to David Berkowitz, it's actually a very interesting turn of events. He has been denied parole so far on 15, possibly 16 at this point, separate occasions. I know the most recent he's tried to get out on parole was May of 2018. And it's interesting because apparently he's had great behavior since he was put in prison. He has not come into any issues. He actually has gone on to help other inmates struggling with different problems, different offenders who have psychiatric problems, suffer with depression, all sorts of things like that. So he's labeled as like a caretaker in the prison, and he even has gone on to form some strange relationship with one of the daughters of a man that was kind of taunted by Berkowitz. I think Berkowitz lived above him in his apartment, and they believe Berkowitz was possibly sending him threatening letters. This man was an officer, so clearly he had an issue with him at the time. So somehow they've developed some sort of relationship, because most of her life, all she was left of from her father was all these different investigations he had done on his own into Berkowitz and the Son of Sam killing. So she writes to him, she visits him in prison. It's a very, very interesting situation. I don't know if he has since stated anything when it comes to the murders of Ronald and Elizabeth. I'd be very interested in knowing if to this day he would still claim members of the Son of Sam cult killed them, or if, since he's this born-again Christian and is apparently a great person according to himself now, if he would maybe say, oh, I made that up for drama. I'd be very, very interested to know about that. But I doubt he's ever going to be let out on parole after what he did. He claims he's a great person now and is not a threat to society, but obviously nobody is willing to take that risk. He is almost 70 at this point and he is struggling with some heart issues, but I don't personally think that's a great reason to let someone out of prison. He even says he has no idea why he committed most of these murders. He said he was in a horrible time of his life, but if you really look into the murders themselves, they were horrific and brutal, and oh my goodness, he just really terrorized New York City for such a long time. No one could be out doing anything. And it was like he would just show up to people's cars and shoot them with no warning. They're just minding their own business. So it was just a terrifying situation for everyone involved. I definitely do think if there was some photographic evidence that Ronald Sisman did have on one of these killings, I don't know what to think, because I feel like that's one of those things you would almost immediately bring forward. And I feel like he possibly would have thought to have brought it forward during Berkowitz's trial when he was thrown in prison just, you know, years before. So it makes me question if this photographic evidence did actually exist. I do find it strange Berkowitz knew a lot of the information, and at this point, there were just a lot of news articles about the murder, so I'm not sure the type of access he would have had to all of this specific information. I also don't know how plausible it is that he could have spoken to anyone in a cult from such a high security prison. He is in a maximum security prison. However, we've all heard stories of how sometimes things just manage to get through. Where there's a will, there's a way for some of these criminals. So there's really no telling. I just find it very interesting that somehow it on a logical level, it really does make a lot of sense. And I can see that he could possibly have been involved. And you know, there did happen to be a motive for why Ronald might have wanted to share the picture to use as leverage. So then on top of that, even the authorities' first reaction was that somehow someone was looking for something in the apartment. So all of it matches up so perfectly that you really question if it's just a created story or if it has to be true. It's really heartbreaking to me that they didn't get any sort of justice for their death, and it's also terrifying that if David Berkowitz or the son of Sam Cult wasn't responsible, that someone else in the city was capable of murdering two people like that. I mean, execution style, beating and ransacking an apartment and somehow leaving no trace of yourself behind, that's terrifying. So I definitely am interested to hear what you guys have to say in the comment section down below. Do you think it was someone who just happened to get away because there was this big thing about the Son of Sam killer at the time? Or do you think this was one of the Son of Sam killings? Do you think there's a cult? Do you think there's not a cult? Absolutely wild to me. So definitely leave it down in the comments below. Don't forget to give this video a like and hit the subscribe button to become a part of the Hallan fam, and I will see you in my next video. Bye guys!